To all who need comfort.
To all who need friendship.
To all who are lonely and need companionship.
To all who need sheltering love.
To all who sin and need a Savior.
John Gray Memorial Church opens wide its doors and in the name of the Lord says,
welcome.
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 Welcome. Today I invite you to spend a little time with me in reflection around the prayer that Jesus gave his followers as a model for how to pray. What we have come to call the Lord's Prayer must be understood in the context of relationship. It is a relationship between the Creator and the created, between Savior and the ones who are saved, so that the prayer calls out, Our Father. The first three petitions in this prayer are hopes that God may act in such a way that God's people will revere God's name, will submit to God's reign, and will do God's will. Our prayers should always honor God's holy name and character, and also be an expression of our submission to God's reign and will. Here's how the psalmist says it in Psalm 77. I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on all your work and muse on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have displayed your might among the peoples. With your strong arm, you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph.
Sing a new song to him who sits
if we are seeking God's kingdom first, then God will answer our prayers according to God's will. Blessings will always be ours as we seek God's accomplishing what God knows best for our lives. So in the prayer we say, "Your kingdom come." The kingdom of God is probably the most important concept in Matthew's gospel. It speaks of the role of God in the universe. God's kingdom is both the present reality of God's sovereign rule in the believer's heart, as well as the future expression of God's kingdom that will be brought into existence when God consummates all of creation. It is both the unseen kingdom, demonstrated in the rule of God in the hearts of people who submit to God's way, but it is also the visible kingdom that God will establish when Christ comes again. So when in prayer we petition God, "Cause your kingdom to come," we're asking God to exercise authority until the world is filled with God's glory. We are desiring for God to establish dominance in all the earth. The kingdom will come in full power, full realization, by means of its own inherent power, the power of love. In this kingdom, God will perfectly accomplish God's purposes of love on earth as it is in heaven. Oh, how we desire that that were the case in our world today, so that hunger and hate, pain and war would no longer be a reality. It is the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 2, verses 2 to 4, who said, "In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as chief among the mountains. It will be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. Many peoples will come and say, 'Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his path.' The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and settle disputes for many peoples. And they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up a sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore."
Make me a channel of your peace.
God's transforming grace can change the desires of the human heart from "my kingdom come" to "your kingdom come." Since Christ lives in the hearts of believers, then Christ helps to develop the desire for God's will in us. As we relinquish ourselves and our self-centered ways, then God in Jesus Christ helps us to choose God's will. The Apostle Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I have been crucified with Christ. I don't live any longer, but Christ lives in me. Now I live my life in my body by the faith in the Son of God. He loved me and gave himself for me. When he wrote to the Ephesian Christians, he said in chapter 3, I pray that God will use his glorious riches to make you strong. May his Holy Spirit give you power deep down inside of you. Then Christ will live in your hearts because you believe in him. And I pray that your love will have deep roots. I pray that it will have a strong foundation. And may you have a power together with all the Lord's holy people to understand Christ's love. And may you know how wide and long and high and deep it is. Here's a bit of truth for us. God's revealed will is being perfectly observed in heaven. We know that when Christ appears, we will be like him. That's because we will see him as he really is. Christ is pure. All who hope to be like him must then make themselves pure. Jesus taught and lived this, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Christ accepted the will of God over his own self-interest and allowed himself to be nailed to the cross. Would you have carried the burden of that cross? The self-centered life says, I am the most important person in the world. But the God-centered life says, God's will be done. The self-centered life is expressed in our driving when we honk our horns and blow people to get them out of our way. It is at the root of our rudeness, whether on the games field or in the grocery store. It is the destructive element in our marriages, where spouses make little effort to be giving and gentle to one another because it is my happiness that counts, no matter what. It is at the center of conflicts and wars between leaders and nations, the desire for whatever the benefit will accrue to the aggressor. Here are two problems with the self-centered life. Firstly, a self-centered life is a life that is out of focus. When you live in the space of me, myself, and I, it puts everything out of perspective so that you don't see truth and reality. You just see a blurry image of it. It distorts your understanding of your need for others, and it prevents you from understanding the needs of others. Unfortunately, it is in our very nature to be self-centered rather than to be God-centered. But the second problem with the self-centered life is that it is ultimately a dangerous and losing proposition. It destroys what it attempts to protect. For example, in the story about an ambitious farmer, he was happy about the yield of his crops and had heard about a highly recommended new seed, this new crop of corn that he wanted to grow. He bought some of it and produced a crop that was so plentiful that his neighbor, who was also a farmer, asked him to sell him a portion of the new seed. But the farmer refused. In his self-centeredness, the success of his crop was all that mattered. He was afraid that if he shared with his neighbor, he would lose a profitable competitive advantage, so he refused. The second year, the new seed did not produce a good crop. And when the third year crop was still worse, it dawned on the farmer finally that his prized corn was being pollinated by the inferior grade of corn from his neighbor's field. Had he shared the seed, his own crop would have been protected. Jesus said in Luke's Gospel, chapter 9, verses 23 to 25, whoever wants to follow me must say no to themselves. They must pick up their cross every day and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it if someone gains the whole world but loses or gives up their very self. A story from World War II about a man who, by giving it all away, literally transformed a whole camp of soldiers. His name was Angus McGilvery. He was a Scottish prisoner in a work camp which was holding other captured soldiers as well. The camp had become a very ugly situation. A dog-eat-dog mentality had set in. Prisoners would literally steal from each other and they would fight for survival. And everything was by the law of the jungle, until the news of Angus's death spread throughout the camp. No one could believe that Big Angus had succumbed. He was strong. He was one of those whom they had expected would be the last to die. But actually, it wasn't the fact of his death that shocked the men, but the reason that he died. Finally, they pieced together the true story. You see, the Scottish soldiers took very seriously the body system that they had. They believed that it was literally up to each of them to make sure that their friends would survive. So Angus's body was dying and everyone had given up on him. Everyone, of course, except Angus. He had made up his mind that his friend would not die. So when someone had stolen his blanket, Angus gave him his own, telling him that he had just come across an extra one. And likewise, every mealtime, Angus would get his rations, take it to his friends. Likewise, every mealtime, Angus would get his rations, take them to his friend, stand over him and force him to eat. Again, he would say that he got some extra food. Angus did anything and everything to see that his body got what he needed to recover. But as Angus's friend began to recover, Angus collapsed, slumped over, and died from starvation complicated by exhaustion. He had given up everything he had, even his life. But here's the crux of the story. The effects of his acts of love and unselfishness had such a startling impact on the prison camp. The feel of the camp began to change. Suddenly, the men began to focus on their mates, their friends, and the humanity of living beyond their survival, of giving oneself away. They began to pool their talents. One was a violin maker, another an orchestra leader, another a cabinet maker, and another a professor. And soon the camp had an orchestra full of homemade instruments, and a church called the Church Without Walls that was so powerful, so compelling, that even the Japanese guards attended the worship. The men began a school, a hospital, and a library system. The place was transformed, and love and concern, which had all but died, was revived, all because one man named Angus gave all that he had for his friend. For many of those men, this turnaround meant survival. What happened is an awesome illustration of the potential that is unleashed when one person actually gives it all away.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk.